Inti is the next question. If the maximum slope of a swale is 18 degrees, what is the minimum slope to consider for swales? When would you avoid using swales on a site? How can I best calculate the depth and width of swales I need for the site I'm working on? Well, there's no minimum slope for swales. They work on flat country. Nothing's exactly flat. But if you've got landscape that's been made flat, like in Holland, below sea level, swales still work on flat, and you can go in any direction you like where it's perfectly flat. The flattest landscape on Earth naturally occurs on salt pans. You're not likely to be on a salt pan. But there's still a little bit of slope. So nothing's perfectly flat in nature, and unless it's man-made flat, it's not dead flat. But even on man-made flat, you can get swales to work because you go below grade and you raise up a little bit and wide on the mound. So when would you avoid using swales on a site? Well, if you're so close to the Arctic Circle that you only have 90 days growing season and it's so cold and cool, there's no evaporation, and you've got very long days in summer with very low light, but good light. So you've got very low sun for 18 hours, it's all usable, you have very little evaporation. You don't need to use irrigation in those climates, you don't really need a swale. Otherwise, where would you not use a swale? Where it's too steep, there's no level of flatness where you can't use one. If you're in waterlogged country, they become chinampas. They become shallow canals. So that's not a disadvantage, that's a great advantage. That can be very, very productive, some of the most productive country. So there's nowhere really that is the limit. Just steepness takes it out. Now, what size? How can I best calculate the depth and width of my swales? Well, if I was to dig a swale in here, so if I pegged here, and because I'm on a slope and I went in horizontally, there'd be a point where I'd take that material over, so I could go in horizontally and dig it over and make a mound here. If I go too far, I've got too big a back cut. So as I get onto steeper country, excuse the building in the background, I'm putting a new stable up down there, but the back cut is what makes it limited. So also, what's the size of the property? How big is the property? You don't put giant swales on tiny blocks of land, and you don't put tiny swales on giant blocks of land. I usually look at what kind of machinery you're using. If you're in a garden, it's usually a wheelbarrow. I want at least to fit a wheelbarrow, a little bit bigger maybe than a wheelbarrow. I comfortably walk around with a wheelbarrow. A bigger, small acreage, let's say, it might be a ride-on mower, or a zero turn mower, or a very, very small tractor. And then we get on to medium size acreage, then you might have a small tractor. And then a bigger acreage, a bigger tractor. A really large acreage might be a very big tractor. And it's best if they fit inside the swale, because in dry times you can track along there, you can deliver organic fertilizer, you can harvest from the swales, whether it's timber over the long term or fruit trees regularly, or any kind of product. It's usually perennial tree systems. Swales are tree grown systems. Generally, in gardens, they can be combinations of vegetables production, bush production, berry production, and fruit trees, if you like. Generally, they're a tree grown system. So the limit is how steep is it? If I go in too far with the steepness, I've got to go quite big on the back cut. I've got to make sure I stabilize the back cut. How big is the mound? Well, the width will make the mound bigger. If I'm on flat ground, I can't cut into the hill because of very little hill. I'm going to go below grade. I'm going to dig down, go flat, and come back up for the mound. Now it's got a shallower, wider trench, or it's got a shallower trench anyway, and the mound is spread out. So actually, when you try and do this on the ground, it all makes total sense as you actually apply this, as you take this as a directive to act, the land actually starts to show you what it needs, because you'll realize I can't leave a vertical cliff at the back of the swale. I can't just leave a vertical cut. It'll fall over if you do that when it gets wet. The clay is in the soil or swell up and they'll fall. So you need to stabilize it back, and it's a set angle for different materials. Another question coming up in a minute, I've seen it, about that very subject. So you've got a back cut, you've got a flat bottom, it's flat lengthways, it's usually flat across. Now the material I get out, I need to make it high enough to hold water back on this slope. But if I'm on flat ground, I don't need very much height to actually gain a lot of water. So the cheapest swales, the most value for money for energy in construction to water you hold, are the flat country swales. If you're 1,000 to 1 fall, which is very, very, very flat, and you put a meter mound up, you can hold 1,000 meters of water behind it. It'll fill the swale trench, which is below grade, and a sheet of water behind that. That's an enormous amount of water. You can't do that here. You're only going to go back a meter or two maximum here because we have a slope. So the land starts to prescribe the type of earthworks. As long as you're looking at stability, always adding the stability component, the land defines the earthwork forms. And now the generator stops from the builder. But anyway, you're getting to hear me a little bit better now. Hopefully you can hear me with that in the background. We've got all kinds of things going on here at Zaytuna Farm, because we've got a new development here of a permaculture eco farm in Hamlet with 8 houses instead of just 1 on site, coming soon. There you go.